لا، نشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، نشهد أن محمدا عبد الله ورسوله، صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه وسلم تسليما كثيرا كثيرا. Last time طبعا you stopped at the time when رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم received the first revelation in غار حراء. And then how he reacted to that when he came to Khadija رضي الله عنها. And he said the famous word, Zammiluni, Zammiluni. Zammiluni surround me, like he was shaking. And then Khadija had to comfort him by telling him that, don't worry, nothing will happen to you. And she started reminding the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام of all the good things he has been doing. And the story started from there. This is what we call the beginning of revelation to Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم. And these are the verses like, اقرأ بسم ربك الذي خلق خلق الإنسان من علق. And that's how the message started. Now I just want you to think with me now. Go back now to Mecca. Go back to Mecca. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. Where there was no one who's a Muslim except Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم who received revelation from Allah سبحانه وتعالى. So one day there was only one person who was a Muslim in this world. And this was, يعني, you are talking about more than 15,000, I mean 1,500 years back, where like Muslim in the sense of the message of Islam. We consider all the prophets came with the deen of Islam to submit to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and so on. But the definition of Islam as Islam that came to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was the only person there. So up until then, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not give him any command more than to stand for himself. اقرأ بسم ربك الذي خلق خلق الإنسان من علق اقرأ وربك الأكرم. So at that time the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام took it personal that this is the message for him. And this is why he was trying to abide by what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded him. Then came the what we call the command to go out and spread the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This came in the known surah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to the Prophet alayhi salatu wa salam, Ya ayyuhal muddathir, qum fa'anzir, wa rabbaka fakabbir, wa thiyabaka fatahhir, wa rujza fahjur, wa la tamnun tastakthir, wa li rabbika fasbir. So this chapter, that Surah Al-Muddathir, basically is the chapter that came to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, so that now he can go out and start giving the message to others. Now, how did the Prophet alayhi salatu wa sallam react to this? He says after these verses, he received a clear command. By the way, some of the ulama say a lot of words about these verses. يعني for instance, Allah said to him, يا أيها المدثر, المدثر means a person who's, الدثار means is what you actually cover yourself or dress yourself, right? And then he said to him, قم فأنذر. Now you go out and warn people from Allah سبحانه وتعالى. وربك فكبر وثيابك فطهر. They say that Allah سبحانه وتعالى told him to purify his ثياب. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala actually cleansed the inside of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the Prophet from inside, seen the incident of the time when the angels came and they cleaned his heart and so on. So it's not like us. We have a double responsibility. On the one hand, we have to purify our outer being and then also our inside. And that's the real struggle. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam didn't have to do this because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did purify him. So he said to him, وَثِيَابَكَ فَطَهِرْ ذَنُ وَالرُّجْزَ فَهْجُرْ وَلَا تَمْنُنْ تَسْتَكْثِرْ وَلِرَبِّكَ فَصْبِرْ. And this is why he started, he took it seriously that this Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what Allah wanted him to go. طبعاً from there on, the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام wanted to know what are the parameters of this message that Allah wants to give him. طبعاً the first message is that believing in Allah سبحانه وتعالى, the oneness of Allah, the day of judgment, that Allah سبحانه وتعالى reminded him of all of this, and this is the sequence of revelations that came to Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم. So he said these verses were actually the guidelines for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam of what he does and what he had to do for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then it's also another thing that we have is that all يعني the commands that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he gave him guidelines of it, what to do, how to do it, and how to go about it. So it was basically something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants him to do it. So then the Prophet alayhi salatu wa sallam was faced with two choices. Now there is a command from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he has to go out and deliver this message. And also, there is the community that he's living in that we will not let go. And they will not let him, if he does that, then they are going to do everything to stop him from doing it. So initially, he started secretly delivering the message. And he didn't come out right from the beginning because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to him, قُمْ فَأَنذِرْ. He just went to the mountain like Ibn Jud'an when he stood up in the mountain and called on people to do this. The Prophet didn't do that because he knew if that is going to be the case, then this da'wah had been buried long time ago. So what he did, he started going to the people that he is going to take from. So he started with the closest people to him. And the closest ever to Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم was Khadija رضي الله عنها. So he revealed to her what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to him. And he basically recited, actually he said, the first recitation that the Prophet said to any person was actually delivering these words to Khadija رضي الله عنها. And Khadija took it from there, that he is the one that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded him to do this. And then Allah later on طبعا commanded him to pray and so on. By the way, even the prayer. طبعا the Prophet himself said that even the wudu, by the way, he said that Atani Jibril, Jibril took him to a place and he said there was a spring of water. And he said Jibril made wudu for him in front of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم and the Prophet did it exactly as he did. And then Jibril led him in prayer, so the Prophet led by him. And actually there are some of the hadith, even the companions used to say that at times we used to be led by Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم and the Prophet was led by Jibril. And Jibril will come in front of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, lead the Prophet, the Prophet will be leading the Jama'ah and then the people will be behind him. So when he was taught about this, he basically conveyed this to Khadija. Like he took it home, he went to Khadija and he says here, this is the hadith that he mentioned here, قال أن جبريل عليه السلام توضأ ثم توضأ معه رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ثم صلى به فذهب رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إلى خديجة. And then he commanded her to do the same thing. He showed her how she can make wudu and how she can be led by him. So this is the first person that came in this, like the first people who accepted Islam privately, that was the Prophet and Khadija radiallahu anha. Now, the second person who accepted Islam was actually Ali ibn Abi Talib. The Prophet didn't go to his children, like he didn't go to Zainab, Ruqayya, Umm Kulthum, and Fatima. He went to Ali ibn Abi Talib. He said, وَبَعْدَ إِيمَانَ السَّيِّدَ خَدِيجَ دَخَلَ Ali ibn Abi Talib وَكَانَ أَوَّلَ مَنْ آمَنَ مِنَ الصِّبْيَانِ. And he took a chance. And he was the first one from the young people who became Muslims. And he took a chance because if his people knew him, they would have got rid of him at the time. So the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام basically what we call confided to him. وكانت سنه at the time it was only 10 years of age. But you know, 10 years of age at that time people are quite mature. It's not the age group that we have today. So he says then كان علي رضي الله عنه أول من أقام الصلاة من الشباب بعد رسول الله وبعد خديجة. يعني it is the Prophet خديجة رضي الله عنها then علي بن أبي طالب. وقد ذكر أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم كان إذا حضرت الصلاة خرج إلى شعاب مكة like he used to go out وخرج معه علي بن أبي طالب متخفيا like Ali used to be going secret to him and then because his uncles and all the people like the Qurashai the people were basically after him and he said كانوا يصليان معا فيصلي رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم and then Ali will be praying by the leadership of رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم in the prayer. Now then, surprisingly, the third person who became a Muslim, like we have what? Khadija, then Ali ibn Abi Talib. The third actually was Zayd ibn Haritha. Zayd was a Mawla. Like he was actually in those days, and I said this many times because in Canada here we face this problem here. In those days, what is known here today as adoption was very common, prevalent. And everybody can adopt a child. And actually Zayd ibn Haritha was adopted by Khadija رضي الله عنها And she gave him to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So he lived with him. And they used to call him Zayd ibn Muhammad. يعني right, they, because they, in those days, if you adopt a child, then you give him your name. And then it become your, just like your son. So, and later on, by the way, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala completely canceled this. When he said, وَمَا مُحَمَّدٌ مَا كَانَ مُحَمَّدٌ أَبَا أَحَدٍ مِنْ رِجَالِكُمْ وَلَكَ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ وَخَاتَمَ النَّبِيِّينَ. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala completely abrogated this. That anyone who adopts a child and gives him his name is false. This is not your child. You are just claiming that your child is not. And this is one of the problems that we have. We have so many Muslims, unfortunately, you know, when they have their relatives and their, like, if they are orphans or otherwise, they will go and adopt them legally so that they can get them into Canada and so on and so on. Lakin, the problem here, they will give them their names. And Allah said, don't give them your names. Give them, ud'uhum li'abaihim. I mean, you call them by the names of their fathers or their parents. And it's false. I mean, you bring a child who's not yours and you claim he's yours. And more than that also, this adoption creates serious problems in the family itself. Let me explain this to you. Assume, I have, mashallah, alhamdulillah, I have boys and girls in my family. Right? I have children who are boys and I have girls. Now, if I adopt a girl, so she comes into my house, right? In her childhood, there is no problem. The minute she matures, she reaches the age of puberty, then my sons are not mahram for her. I cannot live with them. And the opposite is true. If I adopt a boy, then I have my girls in the house. My wife, myself. And this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, you cannot adopt a child in that sense. There is something called kafala in Islam, which is different. Kafala is different. A kafil is a person who can take care of a person, do exactly what these people. The only thing, you don't give them your name, you don't live freely in the house because there are barriers between husbands, wives, children, women, men, and so on. So you have to be careful about that. And that's what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala canceled. I did say this to you before, that very sensitive issues, I'm going to repeat this, sensitive issues that people don't really like, how come, what can they, we just, right? Allah put the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam to do it before anyone else. Remember we said about divorce? One of the most hateful things is when a woman is divorced and you tell her she has to stay with her husband for the period. She'll say, are you crazy? You want me to stay with him? I see the shaitan, I do see his face. How come? But Allah said that. He said, لَا تُخْرِجُهُنَّ مِنْ بِيُوتِنَّ وَلَا يَخْرُجْنَا إِلَّا يَأْتِينَ بِفَاحِشْ. A woman who is divorced, no matter what, she has to stay in her household. She does not have to leave. She does not have to ask to be leave. Allah said this. Allah commanded the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام to do this before anyone else. Same thing with adoption. So Zayd, and this is why I said this about Zayd, was called Zayd ibn Muhammad. Is Zayd ibn Hadi, that's his father. And later on, طبعا, his son Usama became the most loved by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Like Usama, his son, people used to call him Al-Hib ibn Al-Hib, like the loved of the loved one. The Prophet used to love his father, used to love him. But even Zayd ibn Haritha, although he's the third person who became a Muslim, يعني in sequence, as I said to you, we started with Khadija, radiallahu anha, then we came to Ali ibn Abi Talib, and the third in line was who? Zayd ibn Haritha. He said, وَكَانَ مِنَ الْوَلَادِ وَكَانَ حُبِّ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ وَمَوْلَاهُ. He says, By the way, there's another interesting story, Zayd. They said when this revelation came to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that you cannot give him your name, you have give the name of his father, you can keep him as he is, you can do what you want, and I'm going to finish the thing about kafara. The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam called him, and he said to him, Zayd, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded me that you are free to go. He went and looked for his parents, and his parents came. And when they came to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Prophet said to him, it's not that I don't want you to stay with me, but your parents are more worthy of you. These are your parents. So he said, no, he would prefer to stay with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, not to go with his parents, but to stay not as an adoptee, like he's not adopted by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He will keep his name, Zayd ibn Haritha, and then he will stay with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He says, فَتُرِكَ لَهُ الْأَمْرُ فَقَالَ زَيْدِ لِرَسُولَ sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, أَنَا الَّذِي أَخْتَارُ. Like he said to the Prophet, I am the one who is going to choose to stay with me, to stay with you, unless if you don't want me. So the Prophet ﷺ said to him, no. Then his father said to him, ويحك تختار العبودية, like you want to be under Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, you don't want to go to your parents. He said, like my staying with Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم give me more freedom than being with anyone else. And actually his parents after that they left him. Let me tell you about the kafala. The difference between the adoption and the kafala is simple. They are the same in the fact that if you want to have a child, you have an orphan, you have somebody, you can take care of everything from him. Right? The two things you cannot do, one, you cannot give him your name. ادعوهم لأبائي. Two, as I said, if that child becomes mature, then you have to observe these barriers between males and females. And partly for you, like say for instance, if I adopt a girl in my house, then I'm not a mahram for her. And my son is not. Now if I adopt a boy, my wife is not a mahram for him. My daughters are not. So if there is a way you can maintain this relationship, look after him. Rent a place for him, get him this, pay his fees, give him everything. Yani, you can do everything that people do for adoptees. Right? But you cannot give him your name. You cannot keep him when he gets the age of puberty. Unfortunately, in this country, even non-Muslims adopt Muslim children. And you find them treating them like parents. I mean, and there is a lot of abuse cases because this man is not the father of this girl. Emotionally, all of these things, and now our psychologists, psychoanalysts, psychiatrists, whatever it is, they are studying this and they are telling us that no matter what you think, it's not the same. Now, so the kafil, if you maintain these things, you can take care of the person all his life. There is absolutely no problem there. And the other thing, I need to say this to you, because when we deal with this fiqh issue, sometimes we get a little bit. Some of our scholars recently, they said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, look at how, this is very, they're going to be careful. They said, Allah said, ادعوهم لآبائهم. ادعوهم لآبائهم. يعني, give them the names of their parents. But they said he didn't make any reference to their grandparents. Or their family names, or whatever it is. So what they come, this is an opinion. It's not that something like they said, and we have faith cases like this in Canada. We have people who adopted children, gave them their names. Now they are stuck. The minute they know this, now they don't sleep. They don't know what to do. Even the kids themselves, they are disturbed. So these scholars are saying, they say keep their father's name, but you can give them your family name. So for instance. If there is a girl and her name, let's just say Fatima, and then this Fatima is adopted by me, I can't give her my name. I can't call her Fatima Abdullah and so on and so on. Right? But they say I can give her her father's name. Say her father is Uthman. So I call her Fatima Uthman. But I can attribute the last name for her. Yani, because the last name in the family is normally not necessarily the grandfather. So they said, you keep their parents' name as is, that's to solve the first problem, but you can give them the family name so that you can facilitate their legal adoption and so on and so on and so on. Opinion. They said, this is a way out. This is so common in Britain, in Germany, in France. There are lots of Muslims, lots of them. And there are reports that saying that they estimate that almost maybe 20, more than 20% of Muslims adopted children to bring them. And now they are stuck with them. So if you can maintain this relationship with the children, away from the family, and at the same time, you don't give them directly your name. So if the girl's name is Fatima Uthman, she stays Fatima Uthman, this name of her father. Now, you can sponsor under your last name. That's an opinion. That's what some of the scholars now, you know, these scholars all the time try to find solutions to problems that are complicated and people can't find them. So they said, al-makhraj means the way out of this, is that you don't give, because Allah said, ud'uhum li'aba'ihim. Don't take the father's name. So Fatima, Uthman is her father, stays. Now you can adopt, and they also have another thing. There's some mullahs tashab. And they go and look at the traditions in Arabia. Because in Arabia, even during the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they used to have something called an intisab. Somebody will be associated to a tribe or something by a family name. not necessarily their father or something like that, they have them. So this is what happened. Zayd, I just mentioned it because it's something that we just came across it now. The point the brother is making, he said that if you take this opinion that I said, some of the scholars say it, we are reserved about it, but it's there. He says it will create a lot of complications. Yes, it does. And not only this, he mentioned something that I really needed to say, is about inheritance. See, if you adopt a child in Canada legally, he can inherit you. Anyone can inherit you. Lakin Islamically, he doesn't have a share in the inheritance. يا ربنا ما أدى what we call ما هو من أصحاب الفروض يعني. And this is why some of the علماء use another thing. العلماء دائما أوسع في الكلام من النصوص يعني. They say there is something called الوصية المفروضة. يعني there is a وصية that's an obligation. And this is the وصية for two people. They said one for grandchildren of a son who dies. Say for instance, I have my son. He has three children now. If I die, my son will inherit me. Like he will have part of my inheritance, right? And then by virtue of that, their children will benefit from it. But if my son dies before me, right, he has no share because the inheritance basically is divided after my death, not his death. So what happens to his children? So Allah didn't give them a share. And he didn't say by text that the grandchildren should get this. However, the ulama says again, they said that there is a wasiya which is called a wasiya that is a must, mafruda. So you have to give them a share, sometimes equal to the share of the other kids, so that you don't eliminate them altogether. But technically, they don't have a right on the inheritance. Right? And he said the same thing, that if you adopt a child, then there is going to be a problem. What about inheritance? They don't have a share in it. And this is why they say that, this is another issue, I don't want to get into it. The wasiya itself, people have a lot of mistakes about them. People think the wasiya means you write what your son God sends, and this is not the wasiya. The wasiya actually is your charity that Allah gave you, and the Prophet ﷺ said it could be between one third and one fourth of your what's called belonging asked after you die. This is to be given to people who are not in the wasiya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Like not people who don't have a share for what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave them. Right? Yani, say for instance, let me make it simple. Alhamdulillah, now I have five children. Right? I have three boys and two girls, and my wife. My father passed away, my mother, may Allah bless their soul. So if I die, my wife has a share determined by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I cannot do anything about it. I cannot add or subtract to it. ولهن الربع مما تركتم إن لم يكن لكم ولد. Text. They get one fourth if you don't have children. فإن كان لكم ولد, the verse goes one word for word, فلهن الثمن مما تركتم من بعد وصية توصون بها أو دين. So Allah says, if I die, my wife has one fourth if I don't have children. If I have children, she gets one eighth. خلاص, I cannot give more, cannot give less for her. My children, the same thing. للذكر مثل حظ الأنثيين. My father has a share. Now, but there are some people that Allah didn't give them a share. So the wasiya is actually charity. الوصية حقيقة هي a charity, مش هي تقسيم الورث الميراث. And this is what the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام didn't even determine on it. So the scholars say it's between one third and one fourth. Yeah, they say if you have more children, then you take less. يعني تأخذ ربع 25% so that your charity becomes less and تخلي أولاد زي ما قرأ سام more richer. And if you don't have children, it's better for you to protect yourself. ده موضوع طويل بالمناسبة. I can just detail it for you. لأنه كثير many people don't know what the وصية is. بيفتكروا الوصية واحد. بعدين in Canadian law, by the way, one good thing about Canada, the Canadian law does not commit you to anything. يعني you can give anything to anyone you want. أنا كلمتكم هنا. We used to have this lawyer who comes and tells us about the legal وصية. And he says that there is a famous incident. Somebody gave a horse $2.2 million. أوصى الحصان. بعض الناس دي قطة كلب. So القانون هنا يقول لك خلاص we give it to them. The same thing with the children. يعني the law does not bind you. This is the good thing about Canadian law. Yeah, the Canadian law does not say to you, give this to your wife and this to your children and so on. It's absolutely left for you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala binds you by two things. One, you cannot divide the inheritance. Many people here make this big mistake. They are alive and they want to divide the inheritance. If you are alive, you cannot divide the inheritance. Inheritance after you die, then the people who are living at the time, they get shares from it. But in your lifetime, you can give a hiba. Yani, say for instance, I did mention this before, you don't know this. My wife, for instance, I've been married for 45 years, exactly 45 years. Right? Alhamdulillah, we had 8 children, we lost 3 children, she had 8 pregnancies. كل حياتها شغالة الأولاد. She didn't even work a single day in her life. Right? In my lifetime now, I told my kids, alhamdulillah, my kids خلصوا الجامعات, شغالين, عندهم الأولاد, مبحبحين يعني. So I did tell them one time, listen, your mom did all of this, all her life is for you. If I die, technically she has 1/8. يعني نصيبها في الورثة, في الميراث, تمن. So I told them that, يعني for your mom, I have no problem, you mad. I can trust you, but I can't trust your wives. لأن ممكن ولدي يرث مني ومرته تعميه ويدي لأمي لأمه يعني. So I told them in my lifetime I can give a hiba to my wife and I did it. أنا قد أعطيت زوجتي 40% من كل شيء عندي. يعني if I die they will take 40% بس حقها هي ما حقها. And then she gets another 1/8 from the wirath for her. That's her right. The opposite will be true. If she dies before me, so I'm obliged to take 40%, that's hers, take my rubu', Allah gave it to me, and divide the rest to my children, the حقهم بقى. Because it's no longer mine. Did you get that? يعني, you cannot inherit when a person is living. You have to do it after death and so on. So this is what happens with مشكلة الميراث برضو في موضوع ال اسمه شنو؟ The اللهم صل على محمد للضبشة. طيب who's number four? We said number one was خديجة رضي الله عنها. Number two was علي بن أبي طالب. Third was زيد بن حارثة. Number four in list were the daughters of رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. اللي هم زينب بعدين رقية أم كلثوم and then فاطمة الزهراء رضي الله عنها. And he says that وهؤلاء كنا بنات رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. So they were in the household of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and they were the people who came to Islam for that. And he says the house of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that was the only house. I في reference in verse واحدة من الآيات في القرآن تقول فما وجدنا فيها غير بيت من المسلمين. أحيانا يكون في بيت واحد بس وكان بيت الرسول عليه الصلاة والسلام. يعني كل الإسلام كان في بيت اللي بيت الرسول عليه الصلاة والسلام بين خديجة وبناتها وزيد اللي كان مولاهم علي بن أبي طالب. يعني كل that was all the thing that we have. And also they said that these are the people that like witnessed the first prayer to be established. It was established in the house of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم. وكان هذا البيت he says أول بيت اجتمع فيه المؤمنون. لأنه the house of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم even before we moved to Darul Akram and these places, but that was the place of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم. And this is why he says Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala honored that house of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala like blessed the house of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم right from the beginning. He says also that Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala مين عند حديث طبعا كلنا نعرف الحديث انه يولد الانسان على الفطره. He says everybody is born like a Muslim basically on the nature of the faith of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then the family, the parents will change it. فاباه يمجسان ويهودان and so on because that's the influence that will come from Bizan. And this is why he says, this is why by the way, the importance of the family in Islam. يعني حتى بدايه الدين كلها بدات في الاسره. And that's how the family was held. And this why we keep saying to Muslims here that one of the things you have to be very careful, people are destroying the families. Many families are completely destroyed. يعني القوانين الحاجات, the thing they give, the kida, مسائل, they said this in the khutbah من أضع الطلاق. كلي, وأنا والله ما ببالغ. يعني بقول لكم, of every 10 calls, I get 7 about divorce or khula. كل الناس, ده دار يطلق, ده دار يخلع. دار يمشي دار يمشي وبعدين الاولاد في النص كلنا completely lost. وده البدايه اصلا. يعني I did tell you that if you want to destroy a community بيقول اول حاجه تعملها شنو؟ dismantle the family. بمجرد ما خلاص زعزعت الفاميلي المجتمع كله تكولابس. The second they say the teacher انك تبخس من المعلم حتى ان الطلاب ما يكون عندهم تقدير الاهل ما عندهم تقدير المعلمين ولذلك everything collapses. The third in line, he said القدوة. ما في قدوة الآن، قدوة أولادنا اللي هم الرول موديل اللي هم الفنانين وبتاعين الكورة وبتاع هنا. يعني هسه احنا بنتكلم عن الصحابة بتاعين الرسول عليه الصلاة والسلام. continue on this too. يعني this should be the model that our children should know about. يعني هم دين اللي هم يكونوا معاه. And he says يثأر اهتمام بالأسرة أن كل حركة الإسلام، يعني all the movement about Islam, it actually revolves about the family. And once the family is destroyed, then everything collapses. خلاص انتهى المجتمع يعني. طيب، number five. The fifth person who came to Islam is أبو بكر الصديق رضي الله عنه. يعني هو جاء في الترتيب بعد خديجة، بعد علي بن أبي طالب، بعد زيد، بعد بنات النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام، جاء أبو بكر الصديق. قال أنه أول من آمن بالنبي من الرجال الأحرار، لأنه زيد كان مولى من الموالي يعني. فلكن والأشراف يعني. أبو بكر الصديق رضي الله عنه had his position، كان معروف. and the prophet said this by the way، قال والله ما دعوت أحدا إلى الإسلام إلا كانت عنده كبوة وتردد. كبوة means معناه is reluctant، يعني he said well did except أبو بكر الصديق رضي الله عنه. the minute he called him he says، قال إلا أبو بكر الصديق رضي الله عنه والله ما عكم. عكم means he didn't even hinge. He told him about Islam. He accepted the Muslim of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم. And then he says, وكان أبو بكر هو actually this why he became the as Allah called him in the Quran ثاني اثنين في القاري يقول لصاحبه لا تحزن إن الله معنا. Because that's the company that came to Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم from the heavens. And Allah recognized it in the Quran that he will be the person that he has. وكان رجلا he is described هنا قال مألفا لقومه. Like Abu Bakr al-Siddiq was the kind of a person who can bring people, and he brought a lot of people to Islam, as we are going to see, inshallah, as we proceed. Who came to Islam from the side of Abu Bakr al-Siddiq? وكان أنسب قريش, like his lineage, his status in them. وكان رجل قومه يألف, يعني people used to come to him for advice. He was the wisest among them. وقد كان أبو بكر كنزا من الكنوز. يعني he was just like a treasure. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he was very loved by the people from Quraysh. Even his enemies used to have respect for him. That's Abu Bakr al-Siddiq radiallahu anhu. And he says, وَكَانَ مِنَ الَّذِينَ قَالَ اللَّهُ فِيهِمْ الَّذِينَ يَأْلَفُونَ وَيُؤْلَفُونَ. يعني actually this hadith of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم, he says that when he was talking about paradise and who's going to be with Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم in his company, he said, إِنَّ مِنْ أَحَبَّكُمْ إِلَيَّ أقربكم مني منازل ومجالس يوم القيامة أحاسنكم أخلاقا. And he used الموطئون أكلافا الذين يألفون ويؤلفون. He said the closest to Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم in their seating in paradise are people who are of good manners, people are of good conduct. And this will can bring people, can make people. And Abu Bakr al-Siddiq definitely was one of the people that we can هنا. كان أحب الناس إلى قريش وقد تعلق به كثير. Like he was basically, and people used to respect him. As a matter of fact, the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام got a lot of shelter and protection from Abu Bakr al-Siddiq than he got from anyone else. Now look at the people who came with Abu Bakr al-Siddiq رضي الله عنه. قالوا فلذلك عندما تحرك في دعوته للإسلام, يعني Abu Bakr started going out and talking to people about Islam, أسلم معه عثمان بن عفان رضي الله عنه. And he was only 34 years of age. By the way, Uthman died among the oldest of the companions of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم at 84 or something. But when he became a Muslim, he was only 33. And then came with him also Abd al-Rahman ibn Auf. He was only about 30 years, they say, when he became a Muslim. And then came Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas. And Sa'd was young, but he was only 17 years of age. So all of this came with Abu Bakr al-Siddiq رضي الله عنه. ثم جاء الزبير بن العوام وكان في الثانية عشر من عمري. I mean, the الصحابة, most of them are young people, youth, 12 years. That's the way. سعد بن أبي وقاص, الزبير بن العوام, وطلحة بن عبد الله سي, وكان في الثانية عشر من عمري. كان هؤلاء الخمسة, like these five men, were actually the pillars of Islam, and they are the ones who actually anchored Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم, in the sense that the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام relied on them so much that he can establish the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And all of this came and they accept Islam with Abu Bakr al-Siddiq رضي الله عنه. قال وكانوا هم الدعامات الأولى التي قامت عليه الدعوة إلى جانب رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. ثم تتابع الناس بعد ذلك, people started coming as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala يدخلون في دين الله أفواجا. يعني in the beginning they are individuals, one. And then that was select group that actually became the pillars of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to move the da'wah. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala opened the door for them. He says in the تحرك أبو بكر الصديق رضي الله عنه في الدعوة كان واضحا جدا. يعني from the day he became a Muslim, he never stopped actually promoting the da'wah for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then he was going out. وقال أنه أن أصحاب الجاه, like people of caliber, يعني people are rich and so on and so on. Most of them came to Islam because when Abu Bakr came to Islam, all of them said, listen, this must be something, because they used to trust in the wisdom of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq رضي الله عنه. And he says, وكانت صحبة الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم عليه ليس فقط الاستئناس. يعني it was not just he's a companion for him and a friend, but actually he became the real support of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم because of his strength in the way he proceeds, in the way he meets with people. So مرادة الدعوة السرية. So until then, until that, the call for Islam or the da'wah was actually going in a secret. يعني people didn't come out openly to talk about it and so on. So this is the first generation of people who became Muslims with Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم. Now, that's the first one. قول الدفعة الأولى. الدفعة الثانية. He said, جاء دور الدفعة الثانية بعد الإسلام. فأول من أسلم منهم أبو عبيدة بن الجراح, أبو سلمة ابن عبد الله بن مخزوم, ثم عمة رسول الله برة أو برة كوليد برة بنت عبد المطلب, and then الأرقم المخزوم عثمان بن مزعون. These are the first, the second batch that came after this first people that came with رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. And then عبد الله بن مزعون, فاطمة بنت الخطاب. This is the sister, not his daughter. Fatima is the sister of Umar bin Khattab رضي الله عنه. And this is the sister that she became a Muslim and she used to host people in her house. And then Umar heard that she is doing this and he came out to kill her. And then you know the story. That was the reason for him to be a Muslim. قيل أن فاطمة, هي اسمها فاطمة بنت نفيل, but she is the sister of عمر الخطاب رضي الله عنه. And then her husband was سعيد, because both of them they became Muslim. Then came أسماء, the daughter of أبو بكر الصديق رضي الله عنه. And then عائشة, the daughter of أبو بكر الصديق. خباب بن الأرد, and خباب by the way was one of the companions that is a very interesting story. He was a simple man, and he used to be an iron smith. يعني you know people who make swords and so on. So he used to burn the iron. You know, for you to make a sword, the iron has to be like red like fire. And then you start hammering it and sharpening it and so on. So he used to do this for the kuffar. He's a man, businessman. He's doing business. And he said, then he heard about Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he got very excited about the Prophet alayhi salatu wa sallam, this khabbab. And he was young. So he said, one time he forgot that the customers he had were among the worst people in Quraysh. So he started telling them a lot about Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he was, you know, when you get excited, he's telling them how he got يعني, excited about Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, how he got impressed about him. And he was, and these people were listening to him. And they said, this man is dangerous. We should get rid of him. Because if he's going to go out like this, he might turn a lot of people into Islam. So they kept asking him questions. And the poor guy, it's very simple. يعني simple in the sense that يعني طيب, يعني is not simple in the sense that is naive, like يعني رجل to his face. So he started telling them more. And then one of them said, now it's the time for us to get rid of this man. And you know what they did? They took one of these swords from the fire, they cut his shirt, and they start peeling his skin until he fainted. As a matter of fact, he fainted. And then they dropped him and left. So he went to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with, like he showed him what these people did. And he's the one who said to Rasulullah, أَلَا تَسْتَنْصِرْ لَنَا, it's not time that we fight. And then the Prophet used to say to them, صَبْرًا صَبْرًا, be patient. Because until then, any move that the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام had made against Quraysh, it would have wiped Islam out. We won't be Muslims today. And the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام kept the patience. You know how they killed Sumayya and Ammar ibn Yasir, and this was terrible. Yet the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام used to pipe by him and say, what? صبرا آل ياسر فإنه يوعدكم الجنة. because until then Allah didn't give permission. He didn't give the da'wah, but he didn't give him permission to fight people despite all what they did. And even they said after Khabbab, this is why there is a revelation in the Quran where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says أذن للذين يقاتلون بأنهم ظلموا وأن الله على نصرهم لقدير. They said that because of this when Khabbab came to Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم and it was very sad. Imagine a young man, they do all of this to him and people really tortured him. So the Prophet kept saying to him, صبرًا, be patient. Then Allah revealed to the Prophet, أذن للذين يقاتلون بأنهم ظلموا. Like the verse literally says, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grants permission for people who have been unjustly treated. So he thought this would be the permission for them to fight, but Allah didn't. Allah held them back. He said, وَأَنَّ اللَّهَ عَلَى نَصْرِهِمْ لَقَدِيرٌ. يعني Allah knows, so you stay patient until Allah, later on, we know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave permission to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to fight and to rally Muslims. And even the Sahaba, at the time it was difficult for them. And Allah described this in words in the Quran, you'll be surprised. He says that when Allah commanded you now, everyone wants to fight, everyone wants to go and do what these people are doing. Why do we have to do this? And this happens to us. We get so frustrated sometimes, and it's not a matter of just committing suicide and do wrong things. So Allah kept holding them, holding them, holding them, holding them, holding them, holding them. Now Allah came and gave them, okay, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it is time now. Rally the people, go out and fight. Then they were stunned because now they had to face the reality. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described this in the Quran by saying, وَإِذْ أَخْرَجَكَ رَبُّكَ مِنْ بَيْتِكَ بِالْحَقِّ وَإِنَّ فَرِيقًا مِّنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ لَكَارِهُونَ يُجَادِلُونَكَ فِي الْحَقِّ بَعْدَمَا تَبَيَّنَ كَأَنَّمَا يُسَاقُونَ إِلَى الْمَوْتِ وَهُمْ. يعني Allah said, then Allah gave you permission. Okay, go out and fight. He said, now these people are stunned. Fight? It's difficult. And he said, these people now, they were so يعني, held back that the description Allah gave them in the Quran, that it's as if you are, as they say, you are taking them to the death, what is called, what's called a death, the death, يعني, where they are going to be killed. And he said, they started arguing with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Is real? Do we really have to fight? We have to do this? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is why Allah has his divine wisdom. When he gives us some command, when he holds the command, we have to take it as a divine command from Allah, who knows best everything that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows. Should not be hasty, and at the same time, as we say, when it commands comes from Allah, then khalas, we have no choice but to do what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has commanded us. Now, then, inshallah, I think I'm going to stop here because this is a different section. Oh no, let me finish this one. The third patch. So the first patch of those few people, Khadija, Ali, Zaid, Fatima, and her sisters and so on. Then the second patch is this Sahaba of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam that came. Now the third is now all the people in Quraysh who were really, really stood with Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam to fight the battles. Umayr ibn Abi al-As, Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, Hatib, Amr, Ayyash, like all these names that came later on, like people started coming to Islam in that one. Ja'far ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu, his wife Asma' bint Umays, Hatib ibn Atif, Fatima, al-Harith, like he said, his wife was named Fakiha, so she was coming in. Then Shay ibn Uthman ibn Maz'un. These are the names that actually, if you count them, they were not total more than all of these Sahaba of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They were accepting Islam and all, even the third batch that came, they are not more than 100 people. That's all what was Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He says like also, he has here Amina bint Khalaf, Hudayfa ibn Utba, and he mentioned all these names like Khalid, Amir, Aqil, all these names that we hear of the Sahaba, Suhayb ibn Sanan, Al-Sabiqin Islam, Aydan, he said Abu Zarr al-Qifari, all these names that normally we hear, they came late. Actually, they came in the fourth, as he called it here, in the third patch that came to Islam. And he says, from looking at these names, we will find that all the people who came to Islam, in the beginning were just poor people, ordinary people, except Abu Bakr al-Siddiq and the people who came with him, maybe 10 or 15 people for that. He says, وجانب الصلاة في كتاب السور كده أن حديث الأولين, نعم. He says, كان رصيد هذه الدعوة في السنة. He says, this will took between 3 to 5 years. To Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to get this band of people to come to Islam in the beginning. And he says, we will find that most of these people were ordinary people. Most of them. يعني كانوا من الفقراء, من المستضعفين. And this is why, you know, when Ja'far went to the king of Abyssinia, he said to him, who follows Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? And he told him, just ordinary people. It's not like people of celebrities and so on and so on. And this is why he said, these are the people on whom the da'wah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and this deen actually was based. Apart from like Abu Bakr al-Siddiq, Uthman ibn Affan, these few people who were rich, most of the people were ordinary people that came to Islam. He says, يقول استاذ راف, quoting somebody here, he says, كانوا معظم من الأرقاء. Most of them were people who were actually under bondage and they were basically slaves. And they are people who are ordinary people like the workers and so on that came. He says, كان الإسلام يدخل النفوس. Like بطريقة like people used to receive it. And these are pure hearts of people who are simple. Or hands were clean that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala opened their hearts for this da'wah. He says, if we look at like Khadija, Abu Bakr al-Siddiq, Ali, Uthman, Zubair, Abdurrahman ibn Awf, Talha, Abu Ubaidah, Abu Salama, Uthman ibn Maz'un, Sa'id, you know, and he says, Sa'ad ibn Abi Waqqas, Khalid ibn Walid, he said, all of these were actually the few people who are actually had the status in the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And he concluded by saying, this is what we should remember. أولئك هم السابقون الأولون. These are the people that Allah actually praised in the Quran. والسابقون الأولون من المهاجرين والأنصار. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, no matter what we do, me and you, we are not going to be equal. These people are really far ahead of us. And this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala praised them so much in the Quran, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave them that caliber. And he said clearly, لا يستوي منكم من أنفق من قبل الفتح وقاتل أولئك أعظم درجة. He says no matter how you look at it, no matter what كذا, you cannot come closer even to these companions of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم who were among the first people who came to Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم and accepted this message of Allah سبحانه وتعالى. Inshallah I'm going to stop here. Next time, طبعا the section here says استمرار الدعوة, now how the Prophet moved from the few people in his household to the closer relatives and friends of him, to the people that came to Abu Bakr al-Siddiq. Now they have to move into a different place, which is Dar al-Arqam, where they started teaching people in a way. And then it tells you how Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam now was very cautious of the security of the Sahaba, of not to push them to do things that can actually finish all of them. And we are supposed to learn a lot from that, a lot from them. And this was completed by the Quran itself. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, you don't, like no matter what you go through, what people go through, you have to calculate very carefully your enemy. If your enemy is more stronger than you, it will be just a suicide that you go and do something and then they wipe you. And this is why Allah put the formula that I said to you in the Quran. He says that أَيَّكُمْ مِنْكُمْ عِشْرُونَ صَابِرُونَ يَغْلِبُ مِئَتَيْنَ طيب وَأَيَّكُمْ أَلْفْ يَغْلِبُ أَلْفَيْنَ and so on. And then he says you have to have a ratio between 1 to 10 for the people that you are going to face. If the ratio is less, don't move. Don't do anything. Just be patient. And then even for us, he says, الآن خفف الله عنكم. يعني we are not like the caliber of the Sahaba that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said your ratio should be 1 to 10. يعني even the Sahaba, he said, if you don't have 10% of your enemies, don't try to move anything. And that's exactly what you are going to know later on that Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم did when he started going out, fighting Badr, fighting this and that, and he go from there, inshallah. So with this I will say, سبحانك اللهم بحمدك. نشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت نستغفرك ونتوب إليك صلى الله على نبينا محمد وعلى آله